BBC Audio presents The Art of Innovation, exploring how art and science have inspired each other. It's presented by Ian Blatchford and Tilly Blyth. This is a collaboration between Radio 4 and the Science Museum and begins with an introduction read by Toby Jones from Ian Blatchford and Tilly Blyth's book, The Art of Innovation.
Introduction. Throughout history, artists and scientists alike have been driven by curiosity and the desire to explore worlds, inner and outer. They have wanted to make sense of what they see around them and feel within them, to observe, record and transform. Sometimes, working closely together, they have taken inspiration from each other's practice. They have imagined and acted on the world from different perspectives, with different goals and through different means. Complementary perspectives, perhaps, but fraught with tension, and sometimes divergent, answering to competing pulls of subjectivity and objectivity. The Art of Innovation, From Enlightenment to Dark Matter, considers the ways in which this relationship has evolved and expressed itself through 2.5 centuries, from the mid-18th century to the early 21st. It investigates how the ingenuity of science and technology has been incorporated into artistic expression, and how creative practices have in turn stimulated science and technological innovation. What is it that artists do when they draw on science? Are they limited to metaphor and analogy, connected only loosely to the science itself? Or can they offer ideas and themes for scientists to study? Are scientists receptive to such suggestions, and might they usefully adopt artistic methods to help them understand the world? Collaboration between the two disciplines may sometimes be oblique, but it can also be powerful. This is not a grand narrative of the history of science and art. It will not tell you how these disciplines have changed the world. Instead, in a series of stories, we will explore the material, visual, and textual dimensions of the relationship between the two, at particular moments in time and as expressed in particular objects. There is sometimes a tendency to speak in grand terms of what science does and what art does, while attempts to find some generalised common ground often end somewhat limply in vague statements about how they strive for the same thing in different ways. But artists and scientists strive for many things, and both do so within the social, philosophical, and technological contexts of their time. So perhaps the big picture emerges from the small details, by looking closely at what artists and scientists have actually had to say to one another, and what has come of the dialogue. Time and again, we will see that just as scientists typically think visually and have always used artistic practice to understand and explain the world around them, so artists have observed, explored, and been inspired by the ideas of science and natural philosophy. Art has been an observer, critic, and friend to science, and artists have sought to keep step with each scientific advance through new ways of seeing and new tools for making. At the heart of both visual culture and scientific practice is individual imagination. It is widely recognized that art unleashes this most powerful of human capabilities. But science, too, springs from the spark of creativity at its center. "What is now proved was once only imagined," exclaimed William Blake at the end of the 18th century. A truism, perhaps, but one observed repeatedly in science, from Einstein's theory of general relativity to the discovery of the elementary particle called the Higgs boson. Such inspirational and imaginative leaps are not the mythical eureka moments of science, and they do not happen in isolation from their surrounding culture. Take the 17th century physician William Harvey, famous for his work on the circulation of blood. The raw data that Harvey gathered from his endless dissections took shape in his mind within the framework of the literary, religious, and artistic ideas of the time. His was a Renaissance worldview in which the circle was regarded as a perfect form, and notions of cycles and order were part of the classical heritage. Harvey's thinking was formed not purely in the laboratory, but also through discussions with his extensive circle of friends and many hours of reading and contemplation at his country estate. As Thomas Wright notes in his charming and insightful book, Circulation, Harvey was influenced by the phrases and metaphors of his time, a time when physiological ideas permeated culture and language, and the words circuit and circuitous were just coming into common English usage. To put it briefly, it was Harvey's culture, as much as his observations, that recommended to him the idea that the blood circulated in the body. But even if the spirit of the age informs and inflects the currents of intellectual inquiry, might there also be something particular about the psyche of the individuals who make these ingenious leaps of thought? We like to imagine today that innovators are rebels. The Romantic poet, Lord Byron, epitome of the creative rule-breaker, suggested that such individuals appear at first to be putting forward an absurd point of view, precisely because they resist convention and diverge from the consensus. It is, he said, their flashes of imagination that can open up new lines of thought. It's common enough to think of artists as non-conformists, but how does that work for scientists who have to meet professional standards and convince their peers? Here too, innovators seem inclined to break rules and conventions. Think of the mathematician Ada Lovelace, who opposed social norms for women in her time by pursuing mathematics, as her mother encouraged her to do, not to mention by developing a ruinous gambling habit, which her mother would most certainly not have encouraged. Think of the maverick environmental scientist, James Lovelock, who refused to follow a traditional scientific career so that he could maintain his independence of thought. Indeed, many of science's most original minds are revered for their ability to think and see differently from others. But this idea of the innovator as an iconoclastic rebel has to be treated with some caution. New ideas and fresh discoveries also come from the meticulous and painstaking work of artists and scientists who patiently focus their attention on careful, accurate, and often repetitive observations of the world around them. From the artist John Constable, who went out to create over 100 sketches of the sky in 1821 to 1822 in all kinds of weather, to the X-ray crystallographers who waded through data and calculations for hours on end, often working alone, to try to understand the structure of molecules. In art and science alike, detailed and laborious work, often undertaken by teams rather than individuals, is every bit as essential as vaulting imagination and daring iconoclasm. As our 20 stories show, we need always to see thinkers and their ideas in their own context, not in ours. We might celebrate bold inventiveness of thought today, but some prominent Enlightenment figures believed that natural philosophers were at risk of being too confident in their own theories, mistaking them for nature itself. Samuel Johnson cautioned about a disease of the imagination that only sober reason and judgment could subdue. And as the historian Christine MacLeod observes, the myth of the inventor suited the heroic narrative of progress developed by the Victorians. Rather than indulging simplistic ideas of a specific imaginative type, who throughout the age.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.